Welcome, everyone. I'm Jordana Gessler, Vice President of Education and Exhibits at Holocaust Museum LA. Thank you all for joining us today as we commemorate the 82nd anniversary of Kristallnacht and hear from our speaker, Aimee Bikel, author of Theodore Bikel's The City of Light. Holocaust Museum LA is the first Holocaust museum in the United States. Founded by survivors in 1961, who wanted to create a place to display their precious artifacts in perpetuity, remember their family members and loved ones who perished, and educate future generations on human history. Today, the museum continues to provide free Holocaust education to students and visitors from across Los Angeles, the United States, and the world, fulfilling the mission of our founding survivors to commemorate, educate, and inspire. Holocaust Museum LA brings you programs like today's at no charge. If you are enjoying our programs, we ask that you consider supporting our work by going to holocaustmuseumla.org to make a donation and ensure that we can continue our mission. On the night of November 9th, 1938, Jewish shops, dwellings, schools, synagogues, and institutions were targeted in state-sponsored violent pogroms and riots throughout Nazi Germany, including what is now Austria, which had been annexed earlier that year. The Nazis used the latest communication technology, telephones, teleprinters, police transmissions, and radio to spread the orders. Within a few hours, the pogrom reached almost every part of the country without meeting any resistance. 91 people were murdered that night. 267 synagogues were destroyed. Over 30,000 Jewish men were arrested and deported to concentration camps for no other reason than they were Jewish. This was the single largest mass arrestation within Nazi Germany during the entirety of the Holocaust. This was a violent turning point that demonstrated to the community what was to come. Aimee Bikel's late husband, the beloved actor, singer, and activist Theodore Bikel, experienced Kristallnacht as a young boy in Vienna. Her book for young readers, Theodore Bikel's The City of Light, is based on the short story written by Theodore Bikel shortly before he passed in 2015. The book poignantly recounts moments from Theo's childhood in Vienna, the first happy memories of family, sweet cakes and holidays, and then darker times after Nazi Germany, annexation of Austria, and the rise of antisemitism. We will hear about Theodore Bikel's rich and fascinating life from Aimee today. But first, we will hear from our special guest, Andreas Launer, Consul General of the Republic of Austria in Los Angeles. Consul General Launer has held his current post since 2017 and has been in the Austrian diplomatic service for more than 20 years. Consul General, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you very much for this introduction. Let me first of all warmly thank Lammuth for taking up our suggestion to host this book presentation. We love you for all what you are doing. You are doing such a tremendously important work here in Los Angeles. We really thought that also for this event, you would be our preferred and perfect partner. Although we can unfortunately not meet in person today due to COVID, it's still, we are really happy that we can at least connect in this way virtually to celebrate Aimee Ginsberg Bikel for her really wonderful book, The City of Light. I found The City of Light really beautifully written and really very moving. But of course, I found the story about Theodore Bikel's childhood in Vienna around the year 1938 also painful to read, as it reminds us of the darkest hours in the millennial history of Austria. I belong to a generation that has been born decades after the Nazi period, but this period in our history continues to burden us. It is heartbreaking what Austrians did to fellow Austrians and how many of our best compatriots we have lost. In one passage of the book, Aimee wrote that Vienna cannot be without its Jews, and I could not agree more. So much of what makes up my cultural identity as Austrian is informed by Austrian Jewish intellect and creativity. Jewish and Viennese seem really inseparable to me. And although Vienna, fortunately, today is again a thriving and multicultural open metropolis and really mesmerizing for people around the world, we still feel the pain of the tremendous loss caused by the Holocaust. I don't want to talk too much about the book or Theodore Bikel to that, for that matter, and particularly his relationship to Austria when he was older. I would completely like to leave that to Aimee, of course. Just allow me some more general political remarks. I think we who are living today, we cannot change the past, but I think true to the title of Aimee's book, The City of Lights, and true to Theodore Bikel, who was not only a great actor, but also a civil rights activist and a great mensch, I believe. I think our generations must and can do our best to bring a little bit more light into the world today and learn from the tragic past. And I would like to make three short points in this connection. First of all, it's about the fight for our liberal democracies and open societies, in which usually Jewish communities also are thriving. As you all know, this model is under attack today in many parts of the world. Maybe you've heard about this terrible terrorist attack that killed several people in Vienna on the 2nd of November. This is just another reminder in a series of disheartening events in Europe and elsewhere that there's a lot of hate and darkness out there. I think we must remain watchful. And I think you all will know the great historian Timothy Snyder, who teaches at Yale as well as in Vienna, and his famous book on tyranny. And I think this is also a great compliment to Aimee's book and a great guideline for civic behavior in these times. Secondly, and this concerns more our own mission here in Los Angeles and in the United States, I think it's important for our generations to bring together what belongs together. It is an important part of our mission to reconnect to the children and grandchildren of Holocaust survivors and refugees, and to reconnect them to the country and the culture they came from. I'm really happy to inform you in this context, that a new amendment to the Austrian citizenship law has entered into force in September, by which the descendants of victims of National Socialism can acquire the Austrian citizenship by declaration, even if their parents or grandparents did not even have the Austrian citizenship but lived in Vienna before the war in Austria. And I think this is just a great way to reconnect to Austria. It's much more than symbolic. And I think it's a great way to have this Austrian passport. Means more than, it's just more than a symbolic gesture, but it's really a way to connect to Austria. And we have, alone here in the Western United States, which is our jurisdiction, we have over 1,200 cases by now, after 1.5 months. And I would just encourage everybody in the audience, if this law applies to you, please get in touch with us. We would be happy to welcome you to our family. And there's also another point I would like to make concerning our mission here in Los Angeles. Just as Theodore Bikel, there are so many Austrian refugees which made such an important contribution to the development of California in the film industry, in culture and architecture and music and so on. And, to celebrate this Austrian Jewish heritage in Los Angeles, this is also a very part of our mission here. And we have been organizing a lot of events, which will also be continued after COVID is over. For instance, we are planning a great symposium and film show with the Academy of Motion Pictures next year, dedicated to all the Viennese and Austrians who have formed the film industry. It will be called Vienna in Hollywood. And I hope that also Theodore Bikel will be part of this undertaking. And so we do many of these kind of events to celebrate this heritage. And in this spirit, I also would like to once again thank Aimee for having written this book, for celebrating the heritage, celebrating the great achievements and the life of her late husband, Theodore Bikel. I hope that we will be able to celebrate, to continue to celebrate this heritage also in person. In this sense, I wish you a wonderful event. Thank you.
So much. Danke schön, Consul General. It is now my pleasure to introduce Aimee Ginsberg Bikel. Aimee is an author, an award-winning journalist, and foreign correspondent and public speaker. She began her career in Israel as a broadcaster for Galei Tazal, the radio station for the Israeli Defense Forces. She later served for 15 years as the India correspondent for Yedot Ahronot, Israel's largest daily newspaper. After returning to the United States, Aimee married Theodore Bikel, who passed away in 2015. After her husband's passing, she founded the Theodore Bikel Legacy Project. Her first book, Theodore Bikel's The City of Light, was published recently to critical acclaim. We hope to have some time at the end of Aimee's presentation to answer questions. If you have a question, please type it into the Q&A box and we will read it out loud. Before I turn it over to Aimee, let's hear a song from Theo.
Beim Breck von Weldl steht ein alter Bäum, schäppchen seine Blätter, als mein Herz sei koim. Schäppchen und erzählen, wie es starb da hält, wenn es fallen keulen über Wald und Feld. Schäppchen und erzählen, wie es starb daher, wenn es fallen Keulen über Wald und Feld. Dort leben Bäume von Weldl, liegt ein Partisan, Blätter im Verstellen, sie sah Kranz voran. Liegt er, hört nicht, seht nicht, ducht sich Schluft da zint. Liegt der Wind a Werbe, tullet wie a Kind. Liegt er, hört nicht, seht nicht, ducht sich Schluft da zint. Liegt der Wind a Werbe, tullet wie a Kind. Sein alte Mutter weint, leid in ihre Augen und das Herz verstehen. Ich hab dich geboren, sich mit dir gefreut. Jetzt ist alles verloren, Skäfer deins ist greit. Ich hab dich geboren, sich mit dir gefreut, jetzt ist alles verloren, Skäfer deins ist greit. Guck auf meine Tränen, viel wie's Herz tut weh, ach, wel schon kein Mal Herrn, dich nicht sehen, ei weh. Ausgeat Attacken, euch geweiner Held, oben still im Blätter, euch verwiegt in Feld. Ausgeat Attacken, euch geweiner Held, oben still im Blätter, euch verwiegt in Feld.
Good morning, everybody. I'm hoping that we'll go on to speaker view. Is there a way to put me on the in the center on speaker view?
Aimee, you are, I think you are on speaker view for our audience.
Okay, that's great. Okay, good morning, everybody. It's really such an incredible honor to be here with you today. Consul General Andreas, thank you so much for your words. I always love being at events together with you, and often your words bring tears to my eyes. Thank you so much for being here to honor this incredible day and to honor Theo and our book. And thank you to the museum for having us and for hosting this event. I feel a little teary-eyed right at the moment. You know, this is not, we're not commemorating a happy occasion. Sometimes I have this event during a holiday or for Hanukkah. I speak about Theo, you know, for Rosh Hashanah or Independence Day or for his birthday. And it's very easy to just connect unequivocally to his great spirit of joy and of love and of happiness and to just go along with it. On an occasion like this one, it is a little bit harder to give over to the joyful spirit of Theo when we're here to remember and to think about a more difficult and solemn occasion. But I was talking about it to my niece the other day, and we thought together about how there's really no better way to honor our holy survivors and our holy victims and, you know, everyone that we've lost, everyone who fought through and pushed through, really no better way to honor them than with our joy and with our spirit of resilience and commitment to continue on and to enjoy everything this beautiful life has to give us. Because why not? Why should we sentence ourselves to a life of sadness and to a life of suffering when there's joy and love out there to be had? And if we can orient ourselves again and again towards what beauty there is in life, while honoring and keeping with us close and in our heart, our beloveds who are gone, who have suffered, who have been victims of great and horrible cruelty, if we can keep them with us in our heart and take them forward into the light, then what better gift is there for us to give to them? So I'm saying all of this to acknowledge the immense and terrible solemnness of this occasion. 82 years ago today, our ancestors, some of us who might be watching today, some of our parents, some of our grandparents, were going through and began an age and an era of unspeakable horror. But here we are today together. And this was definitely Theo's message, who felt the pain and felt the sorrow his entire life, the pain of a survivor, the guilt of a survivor, but the joy of someone who can't help but look around and see that we live in a life that's so beautiful. So I'm just gonna stop for a minute and make sure that my view is correct. Am I on speaker view for everyone? Because I'm not seeing myself properly, but if I'm, someone can nod for me. Jordana, am I? Okay, great, wonderful. So we are here today to celebrate Theodore Bikel. We're going to hear something about his life, and we're going to talk about and hear readings from our book, Theodore Bikel's The City of Light, a book which I miraculously co-authored with my beloved husband after he passed away, a great and wonderful magic trick. Theo had been asked to write a story for NPR and for Moment magazine about Hanukkah about a year before he died, 8 months before he died. And he wrote this exquisite, very short story in the third person about a boy and his beloved city and what happens to the boy in his beloved city. And about 2 years ago, I was approached by a publisher, Moment Books and Mandel Bilar Books together, to take that story and publish it into a book. But it was too short to make it into a book. And so I took upon myself the you know, with great humility, the fabulous task of commingling my words with my beloved husband's words. I know his voice so very well, and I was able, blessedly, to take that short story that he wrote and expand it into a much longer story, which I believe is seamless. I challenge anyone to point out which part of the story he wrote and which part of the story I added in. And then I was able to add in an afterword and a foreword and lots of glossaries, and we'll get to some of that today. But besides my talking about the book, we're going to enjoy ourselves with clips from songs from Theo and from interviews from Theo. I guarantee we are going to go long. I'm sorry about that. We've tightened the program and shortened it, but we will go longer than an hour, there's no doubt. I hope you're able to cast aside some of your responsibilities for the next hour and to stay with us until the very end, because it's just going to get better and better. So without further ado, I'm going to start to read you a little bit from the book and we'll get on with our program. Theodore Bikel's The City of Light, which has won, has started to win awards to our great pride and pleasure. The sticker that you see here is for the Indie Press Award by Forward Mag, it's not our publisher, it just happens to have the same name, but the Forward Indies Press Award we've won the silver medal for children's nonfiction. And I'll tell you about the rest of our awards as we go on. This is from the Forward. This is in the woods of Vienna. Noah Phillips illustrations. Once upon a time lived a marvelous man named Theodore Bikel. He was a famous actor and a singer who was full of goodness and joy. He laughed a lot and loved singing and playing his guitar. If you asked your grandparents or maybe even your parents about him, they'll probably say they saw him in TV, in the movies, or in the theater, and maybe they heard some of his records. Theo loved being Jewish and worked hard to make this world a better place for all people everywhere. He always told a lot of stories about the interesting things that happened to him during his long and wonderful life. Most of his stories were funny. Sometimes they were sad. The older he became, the more he told stories from when he was a small boy back in his birthplace, the city of Vienna, in a country called Austria. At that time, his name was Theo, the German nickname for Theodore. There was one memory that he loved best of all. In this special memory, Theo is doing one of his favorite things, exploring the Vienna woods with his mama Miriam and his papa Joseph. Even though the woods were only about an hour away from the city, going there was always a special occasion. Mama, with her cloth bag of delicious sandwiches, red cherries, sweet marzipan, and a thermos of hot tea, would settle down on the checkered blanket and prepare their picnic. Young Theo and Papa walked along the trails, singing loudly in German, in Yiddish, and in Hebrew. They sang Jewish songs, songs about building a beautiful new country for the Jewish people, and songs about a better world for all working people everywhere. Never forget these things, Papa would tell him. They are the most important. After their picnic, chilled from the wind and the damp of the earth, they would stop at the inn at the edge of the woods for a bowl of chicken soup with liver dumplings. The innkeeper always smiled at young Theo and gave him a few extra dumplings so he would grow up to be big and strong. Theo could not imagine the horrors that would come so soon. He could not imagine that almost overnight, their neighbors, his teachers, even the innkeeper would become enemies full of hatred and malice simply because he was a Jewish boy. He could not imagine that he and his parents would have to leave his darling Oma, grandmother, behind when they escaped from Vienna. They got out just in the nick of time and were able to move to Palestine, which later became Israel. Even though Mama and Papa had tried with all their might, they could not get an extra entry permit for Oma. "I am old and Theo is still very young," Oma said. "You must go now and take my Theo to safety before it's too late." They were only allowed to take one suitcase each, how much can you possibly fit into one suitcase? During the voyage across the Mediterranean Sea, they felt excited about their new life, but heartbroken that they had to leave so much behind. Worst of all, Oma, but also their friends, their beloved books, and most of the things they had owned. So I'm going to stop right here and we'll get back to the book as we continue our event. And we'll get back to the events of Kristallnacht and all in the book. But parallelly, I'm going to continue on with Theo's life. So Theo, they actually arrived in Israel right before Kristallnacht. In the book, the boy in the book does experience Kristallnacht. But actually, the Bikels arrived on Erev Rosh Hashanah, 1938, in the port of Tel Aviv, after having escaped Vienna really by the skin of their teeth. After the Anschluss, Joseph Bikel, my father-in-law, ran about trying to get entry permits to somewhere. And at some point, the British mandate gave the Jewish community in Vienna 10 entry permits, which were divided up equally among the different Zionist factions. And Joseph Bikel was the head of the labor Zionists, of the social Zionists in Vienna. And that's how they came to get their 3 permits that included Mama, Papa, and young Theo without Oma. So they arrived in Tel Aviv quite happily, actually, because they were very staunch Zionists. And Theo was immediately sent off to a kibbutz, into an agricultural school in a kibbutz. That had been their plan all along, from when he was a little boy in Vienna, that he was going to be a pioneer, a chalutz. Most of you here know what a chalutz means, a pioneer, and build up Israel through the fields. But he tells how very soon he discovered that he had no talent and no love whatsoever for the agricultural life. But what he did find out is that he had a lot of talent to stand on piles of manure with his guitar and sing songs about the beauty of the labor that he was no longer willing to do. And so very soon Theo left the kibbutz, and as a young man, 19, 20 year old, he went to Tel Aviv and discovered his incredible love for acting, which led him to found the second national theater of Israel, the Comery, after leaving the Bima, and soon finding out that he felt like a small fish in a small pond, a large fish in a small pond. And he received his papa's permission in 1946 to sail to London and to join the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts. And so he did that without an awareness of how terrible things were in Europe at that time. Like many people in the audience, those were years where people knew and didn't know exactly what was going on. So Theo arrived in London and went on to really have the time of his life, studying at the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts, performing for the Queen in the final show. The Queen mentioned him. She liked his performance very much. And he had a great career in the West End, where he played in Streetcar Named Desire opposite Vivian Leigh, directed by who he calls Larry, Sir Laurence Olivier. Also acted in a play of Peter Ustinov, The Love of Four Colonels, and played his guitar all the time, played Russian gypsy songs and played folk songs. He never stopped singing till the day he died. He sang all day long. And he was discovered by the high society of London, including Princess Margaret, who loved his singing so much that she decided he had to come home and sing for Mummy. And so 26-year-old Theodore Bikel made his way in his beat up car with his beat up guitar to Buckingham Palace and gave what probably was the only private Yiddish concert ever to the Queen, to the Queen Mother, and to Princess Margaret. He sang many songs, but this is a song that I don't know if he sang it or not on that evening at the concert in Buckingham Palace, but we're going to hear it now. It's a song which he is very well known for singing, Erev Shoshosh Shanim, a love song, Evening of Roses. Please hear Theo.
Erev Shel Shoshanim Netzena El Habustan Mor besamim ulevona leragelech miftan. Erev shel shoshanim nitzena el habustan. מור בסמים ולבונה לרגלך מפתן לילה יורד לאט ורוח שושן נושבה אבא אל חשלך שיר בלט זמר של אהבה לילה יורד לאט ורוח שושן נושבה אבא אל חשלך שיר בלט זמר של אהבה יונה רושך מלא כללים פיך אל הבוקר שושנה הכתף נולי שחר הומה יונה רושך מלא כללים פיך אל הבוקר שושנה Ektefenu li Laila yored leat Vruach shoshan noshva Hava el chashlach shir balat Zemner shel ahava Laila yored leat Vruach shoshan noshva Ava el chashlach shir balat Zemmer shel ahava Zemmer shel ahava
I want to mention that this song was recorded in our living room about a month before Theo passed away at the age of 91, quite ill at that time. I don't think that you heard that in his voice, but he was singing that song for many years as he did all of his songs. Later, we'll watch him singing songs as a much younger man. So now we're going back, he recorded it at 91. We're going back to when he's 13 years old. And this is Theo's voice from the book, Theodore Bikel's The City of Light. The boy was 13. The city he lived in was all light. A city of waltzes, of sweet confections. Through the windows of the coffee houses on every corner of every lane, he watched the intellectuals debate and play chess. And although he was too young to take his place among them, it was a foregone conclusion that his time would come. The boy was a Jew, and he liked his people and their stories, their legends, and their mysteries. The small apartment that he lived in with his papa, mama, and oma was full of books about Jewish kings and queens, fantastic journeys, and a magical burning bush. His favorite book was large, very old, and covered in red leather. It told the tales of long ago heroes like Judah the Maccabee and his brothers. An only child, the boy liked reading these stories at bedtime and would fall asleep, imagining that he was part of their adventures. So maybe he never became part of the Maccabees' adventures, but he certainly had many adventures of his own. So we're jumping back ahead in time. He's in London and he's discovered kind of worldwide. And the next thing he knows, he's cast to this movie called The African Queen. And he's reviewed very well for that film. And he starts to get cast in other American films and is brought over to New York to star in a play called Nights in Samarkand, which never really got off the ground, but he was very much noticed. And after some time in New York, which he loved so much, he used to say, I lived in England for 6 years and never did I feel like a Britisher one time. And I was living in New York for 6 weeks and that's it. I was a New Yorker and I was an American. I want to mention that English was Theo's fifth language German and Yiddish were what he spoke to his parents as a baby. Hebrew was his next language because his papa, such a staunch Zionist and not a wealthy man, actually a very not wealthy man, put aside his money to get a tutor, a more, a teacher, to come to the house and teach five-year-old Theo Hebrew. So Theo was speaking Hebrew before there was an Israel, as we know it. It was still Palestine. Hebrew had not been adopted by anyone, but Papa Joseph wanted Theo to speak Hebrew. That was his third language. His fourth language was French because he had cousins in France and they went there every summer for beautiful holidays. His fifth language was English. So those of you who knew him or heard him with his glorious English, that was his fifth language. So he moved to New York and soon was cast to be the star of a play called The Sound of Music. We all know that play, but no one knew it then. It was just beginning. Theo was cast to be the original Captain Von Trapp. And he tells in his stories how the play that began much more staunchly and clearly, Hitler was mentioned by name, the Heil Hitlers were Heil Hitlers, the Holocaust was there, was hinted at and spoken of directly in many ways. As the previews to the show, because shows, you know, they start in other cities and make their way to Broadway. And as the show made its way to Broadway, it mellowed out a little bit. It took out some of the worst mentionings. It's back in the movie, but on the show itself, they made the whole thing a lot more moderate because they were afraid of how the audience would react. And this bothered Theo. He loved being in the show, but he carried around a guilt about the show as well. Again, it's back in the movie, but in the play itself, he felt that it didn't do justice to the survivors and to the memory of the survivors and to the memory of the horrors that had happened just, you know, a decade earlier. And after 2 years, he left the show and he felt a kind of a relief. But he had great times and he loved it. What people don't know is that Edelweiss, that beloved song, was written for the show, for Theo. During rehearsals, Rodgers and Hammerstein heard him singing backstage. He always sang, he never stopped. So they heard him singing backstage. They said, oh, we should write him a song. And they wrote him Edelweiss. And one of Theo's favorite anecdotes, the song was written right then for him in English. But Theo loves to tell the story of a little old Austrian lady who met him backstage one day after the show at the stage door and said in German, oh, I love the show. I loved it so much. I loved you. I loved everything. Especially I loved the song Edelweiss, which of course my mama sang to me every night as a young child. But of course she sang it to me in the original German. So there's something about that song that even though it was new, it immediately has the feel of a classic. Let's hear that story in Theo's words and let's hear him sing that beloved song.
We were in Boston and we had already been out for at least 10 weeks, if not more. And, you know, we were still futzing around with bits and pieces in the show. Rodgers and Hammerstein decided that there was something lacking in the score and had to do with the fact that I was in the cast.
And could play the guitar.
So they said, we got to write him something. It was Edelweiss. And it was the last thing that Oscar Hammerstein ever put lyrics to.
Edelweiss, Edelweiss, every morning you greet me, small and white, clean and bright, you look happy to meet me. Blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow, bloom and grow forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, bless my homeland forever.
Of course, young Theo had a very different life than the Von Trapp children. We're going to go back to a little bit from the book. I'm skipping over a lot, of course. This is just a little taste for you. From time to time, Papa took the boy to visit the Stadt Temple, the old and grand temple by the river. It was a wondrous place. The boy never tired of going there, running his fingers on the smooth, polished wood and listening to the beautiful music. He especially loved looking at the Ner Tamid, the eternal flame glowing above the Holy Ark. The rabbi told them that the eternal flame shows us that our spirit can never die and that goodness and truth will always light our way. It seemed to him that this eternal flame must be the secret source of power illuminating his beloved city. These words of the rabbi, that goodness and light will always light our way, and the constant teaching of his socialist father, Joseph, who never ever stopped speaking about the importance of working to make this world a better place for all brothers and sisters everywhere, for our Jewish brothers and sisters, and for all of our brothers and sisters everywhere. These words permeated Theo's being. So he was Jewish with every bit of his existence. I've said this before, if you would wake him up in the middle of the night and say, quick, what are you? He would say Jew 10 out of 10 times. That's what he was. He was a Jew. At the same time for him, what did that mean to be Jewish? It was not a halachic thing. He was not an observant Jew. He didn't even keep kosher. What Jewish meant to Theo, what it meant to him was love thy neighbor as yourself and fight forever to make the world a better place, to bring light unto the nations. And so Theo brought this conviction with him everywhere he went because there was no choice. It was who he was. While he was still in Palestine, while he was in London, and certainly when he arrived in New York and melded and mashed immediately with the civil rights movement, which was very active and very powerful at that time, he became very active around the clock. He was active in SNCC, in the Student Nonviolence Coordinating Committee that were registering Black voters to vote in the South. He gave money, time, he hosted people, he arranged illegal things, illegal in the way of segregation, right? Anti-segregation. He went to jail several times for justice, to my great pride. And he was involved later on in Free Soviet Jewry movement. He was very involved in the anti-apartheid movement. He spent a night in jail for that as well. Never ended with his activism. Which was very connected to the folk music scene, as we know. He became very close friends with Pete Seeger and with Peter, Paul, and Mary, and you know, and then with Bobby Dylan and with all the people that were working hard to use their music in service of Tikkun Olam, in service of fixing the world and making it a better place. And at some time, quite early on, he and Pete Seeger together founded the Newport Folk Festival, which gave us, you know, such greats as James Taylor and Judy Collins and Joni Mitchell and Bobby Dylan and Peter, Paul, and Mary and Pete Seeger. I mean, that's, I'm not saying that, and Arlo Guthrie, that's where they really started singing and came together as a movement, was at the Newport Folk Festival. I would like us to listen to a few words of Theo's about his commitment to Tikkun Olam, and then we'll continue from there.
So just to pick up on that thread,
right.
Where did your investments in civil rights and social justice, was that something that was a long time part of your life?
I can't see how I could have possibly avoided it. Having been at the receiving end of discrimination, of persecution, having narrowly escaped being caught up in the disastrous fate that befell so many of my people, I couldn't see injustices perpetrated on other people and not do anything about it, not say anything, not yell anything, not sing anything. When I got involved in the civil rights movement in the South, North and South, actually. There were Jewish people that I knew who kind of took me to task. Why are you so involved? Huh? Don't we have troubles of our own? When they hit on Jews, that's when you should be involved. I said, you don't understand.
Ooh. Bear with us one moment while this buffers.
You don't understand me. He said, whenever I see an injustice, the victims in my mind become Jews. It's an easy switch. That's true to this day. And I don't understand people who think that they have the luxury of not doing anything, of not saying halt. Not everybody on our street was a Nazi in Vienna. Obviously not. There were some decent non-Jews, but they also did not call a halt to what was happening around them. And today, even though I have to give him credit for not having participated in the barbaric acts, I can't absolve them entirely of guilt and complicity, because non-action is an act, and silence speaks.
This was a theme that ran through Theo's life all of the time, silence speaks. And he, every time he spoke, every time he sang in every concert, he spoke with all of the weight of his authority. If you stay silent in the face of injustice, and if you stay silent in the face of criminality, of prejudice, of persecution, then you have to realize that in some way you are taking part of it yourself. And even if it's one word, even if it's one small action, you must act. Okay, we're back to Theo, a little Theo to Theo. But all was not well in the City of Light. The boy's mama and papa had told him about anti-Semitism. Sometimes the Gentile boys in his classroom yelled out insults and taunts about Jews killing Christ and about being dirty. Why are they doing that? The boy thought. They know I didn't kill anybody, and they can see that I am very clean. He tried to understand it, but it just didn't make any sense. The City of Light could not live without its Jews, and the city knew it. The boy knew that people looked up to the Jews as much as they looked down on them. He could tell that the people of the city actually admired the Jews in many ways, and this made him feel proud, but also nervous, because he understood that with the admiration, there was also envy, and that sometimes envy turned to hate, so that you could never be sure of where you stood. And then he tells about how, even though things were growing and getting worse, people still continued to waltz and eat their cakes and debate in the coffee houses and ignore the litany of hatred that was coming from across the border and even from people in Austria. And they just continued to waltz. And then it happened. The tanks and armored cars rumbled across the border. Unstoppable and unstopped. Within days, the boy saw elderly Jews spat upon and beaten. Elderly women were forced to clean the sidewalks with their coats, and men were forced to scrub the streets with their toothbrushes. School reopened, and during the morning assembly, the principal made a speech in which he declared, "If in the first exuberance of joy, excesses should happen, we will not be inclined to prevent them." What that meant was that the principal and the other adults promised to look away if anyone wanted to bully the Jewish children. Sure enough, a few hours later, a group of older boys burst into his classroom and asked the children to point out the Jewish students. The teacher stood silently as the boy and his 9 Jewish classmates were dragged from the classroom and beaten. when he came home from school, bruised and bloody, his papa wept. So we ask ourselves, how can someone that went through all of these things remain so happy and full of joy? And I think that we're slowly starting to answer that question, because he cared about so many people. And when you care about so many people, it fills you with joy. Theo used to talk about two golden chains that run through him, one being horizontal and one being vertical. And the vertical chain that he felt connected him to all Jews that had ever been and to all Jews who will come, and how being connected to them at all times made him feel strong and powerful. That was his vertical chain. And then he had a horizontal chain that connected him to all of his brothers and sisters around the world, also the Jewish ones of all kinds, Orthodox, not Orthodox, Ashkenazi, Sephardi, all of the different kinds of Jews, but also to all brothers and sisters who spoke all languages and of all religions around the world. And I think when you're tied to existence like that, with that kind of a golden chain, it brings joy for you. So Theo's career continued with immense success. Those of you who know him from those times know his success knew no bounds. Concerts every night, civil activism, folk singing, movie after movie. You cannot turn on the TV today, not one day, without seeing a show that Theo is in. I have my TiVo set. Well, Theo set it and I never unset it, to record all of the shows when he's in them. And that TiVo is off every day, sometimes several times a day, because he was in all of the TV shows, all of the serial shows, and there's movies of him all of the time. At the same time, being committed to social justice. And then came a role that was a role of a lifetime. He was asked to play Tevye in Fiddler on the Roof's national tour. He did not play it on Broadway, but from then on, he went on to play Tevye 2,284 times, more than ever any actor ever played it, and really came to define the role. Sheldon Harnick, who wrote the book to the songs of Fiddler on the Roof, says how all of the actors before Theo did it always with a lot of shtick. They added a lot, or they made it very Yiddish theater. And the first time he saw Theo do the role, he got a little worried because Theo was not adding shtick. He was just playing the role in a very serious way. And as the time went by, he thought, oh, he's not relying on shtick because he knows the role from the inside. And there's no reason to use shtick because Tevye is a deep enough personality that the role can just be played as written. So Theo played it on probably every stage around the country from the age of 30 something all the way to the age of 87 when he played Tevye for the last time. His late and great wife Tamara Brooks used to call the show Shalom Aleichem Light. For those of you who've read Shalom Aleichem, you know that there's a lot of laughter, but there's a lot of tears. It's very dark. It's very difficult. Our life in the shtetl was difficult. There was love. There was our spiritual beauty. There was the beauty of community, but it was difficult every day. All of us have relatives or our own ancestors, our own grandparents, our own parents who escaped narrowly from pogroms. We know what that suffering was like. And Fiddler on the Roof, Theo felt a little bit aired on the side of frivolity and fun. Still, he loved doing it. When asked what was his favorite scene, he always said the scene with Huddle at the train station when she's singing, "How can I hope to make you understand why I do what I do?" And she's off to be with her beloved in Siberia. But that is not the song that people remember the most. And Theo, everywhere we went, if it was a dinner party or a concert for 5,000 people, asked for one specific song from Fiddler. I'm sure that you know which one it is, and we're gonna hear it right now.
If I were a rich man, you would be my viva, you would be my viva, viva, viva. All day long, I'd be the bitty bum. If I were a wealthy man, I wouldn't have to work out. You would be my viva, you would be my viva, viva, viva. If I were a bitty, bitty rich,
Yidle, deedle, deedle, idle man. I will have a big tall house with rooms by the dozen, right in the middle of the town. A fine tin roof with real wooden floors below. There would be one long staircase just going up, and one even longer coming down, and one more leading nowhere just for show. I'd fill my yard with chicks and turkeys and geese and ducks for the town to see and hear, squawking just as noisily as they can. And each laugh, as if to say, here lives a wealthy man. Boy, if I were a rich man, all day long I'd pity, pity, bum. If I were a wealthy man, I wouldn't have to work hard. If I were a pity, pity, bum, I'd see my wife, my golden, looking like a rich man's wife with a proper double chin, supervising meals to her heart's delight. I'd see her putting on airs and strutting like a peacock. Boy, what a happy mood she's in, screaming at the servants day and night. The most important man in town will come to follow me. They will ask me to advise them, like a Solomon the wise. If you please, let them you. Pardon me, let them you. Those in problems, they will cross their red by his eyes. Yappy, 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 yappy. They think you really know. If I were rich, I'd have the time that I lack to sit in the synagogue and pray, and maybe have a seat by the eastern wall. And I discuss the holy books with the learned men 7 hours every day. That's to be the sweetest thing of all. All day long when pity come. If I were a wealthy man, I wouldn't have to work hard. Yabba bibba bibba yabba bibba bibba bibba. Lord, who made the lion and the lamb, you decreed I should be what I am. Now I'd spoil some vast eternal plan. If I were a wealthy man.
I apologize that the quality of the video wasn't so great, but I hope that you enjoyed seeing Theo do that role at the age of 86 or so. I think that's how old he was. We're back to Theo's childhood. And he tells about the terror that grew and how they had to hide behind the windows. Theo's family, they lived in an apartment on Maria Hilferstrasse, which is a main thoroughfare in Vienna. And it is where the parade after the Anschluss, the parade went down the street right under their window, and they hid. Mama, Papa, Oma, and young Theo, 14-year-old Theo, they hid behind the curtains, and they saw the limousines, the open limousines right down the street, and they saw Hitler sitting in the open limousine. And they saw their neighbors, as he says it, hailing and hailing with great enthusiasm out of their windows. And he said, with Nazi armbands, he says, just a day ago, I went down to the shop at the bottom of our apartment to buy bread and eggs. The neighbors had been as friendly to me as usual. And here they are a day later with the Nazi armbands hailing and hailing, letting us realize that we have no place here anymore. Where, how had this all happened overnight? Then came the night of broken glass, the night of horrors. Houses of worship, shtiebels, and synagogues were smashed, sacred objects defiled, Torah scrolls torn and trampled on, and the Stadt Temple, the beautiful, wondrous temple where his papa liked to take him from time to time, where the wood was so smooth and the Ner Tamid was supposed to glow eternally, was smashed and shattered. Where, oh, where is Judah Maccabee now? Where is the liberator of my people? The boy wondered. But even if he was to come, the eternal light was so thoroughly demolished that not even one drop of pure oil remained. The light could not be rekindled. The devastation continued, proceeding from mayhem to murder, from town to town, from country to country. It seemed there was no way to stop it, and it seemed like it would never end. One day, the boy walked home and took a shortcut through the park, the same shortcut he had taken many times, but now the area was forbidden to Jews. He knew it was forbidden, but on this day he was a little tired, or maybe he had to hurry home for a Hebrew class, or to help his mama with some chores, or maybe he plain forgot. Some hooligans, other children, spotted him and started to chase him. "There goes one of them, let's get him," they said. They almost caught up with him, but although he was not really good at sports, he ran for his life and made it home in one piece, pale, panting, and afraid. That night, he had a dream. He dreamed of a glorious rescue. A band of brave and strong Maccabees, with Judah at the head, tall and golden with great locks of long black hair, had arrived in the city and brought redemption to the people. The boy watched with amazement and relief as the men, his heroes, reconsecrated the temple and rekindled the Ner Tamid, the eternal flame. All at once, the temple was filled from edge to edge with a great and brilliant light. The wonder of it made the boy smile in his sleep. But when he awoke, he was in the dark, back in the place of oppression. He realized there had been no Maccabean liberation, and he wept. And the rest of the story is here. So Fina, we're gonna skip the interview with Judy Collins for lack of time. And I'm gonna tell you now about, without reading it, I'm gonna tell you about the afterword of the book, which for me is the centerpiece of the book, the centerpiece of Theo's legacy, even though it happened towards the end of his life, the one seminal event from which everything flows backwards and forwards in time. And this is the story that I want you all to mark in your hearts and to mark in your minds, to tell it to everyone that you know and to remember it forever, because it was a change in history, a blessing, and something very holy. So some years ago, Theo won the Austrian Cross for Arts and Sciences. It's like the highest award that's given to artists. And he won it for his music, for his acting. And he traveled to Vienna to receive it. It took many, many years until Theo was able to go back to Austria, I mean, emotionally, and he just didn't do it. But when he started to go, he liked it. It was his home, it was his childhood home. And even though there was all the pain that was there in being there, there was a great joy in recognizing the park or the tree or a theater or a coffee house that maybe he had coffee at with Papa many times. So there was this, you know, great mixed feeling, which I think a lot of survivors have when they go back to what was their home. So while he was there, he made great friends with an incredible woman whose name was Barbara Prammer, and she was the president of the Austrian Parliament. And unfortunately, she passed away of cancer at a young age. But at that time, they became friends, and she became an admirer, and she had an amazing idea. And she invited Theo to come and sing at the Parliament for the 75-year anniversary of Kristallnacht. And not in a side room, not in an auditorium, not in some, you know, patio in the front, but actually in the Parliament room itself, where the law of the country is made. And so we traveled. I had the great and immense honor, I would say the honor of my lifetime, to be present at that event with Theo's accompanist and friend, the great accordion player, Miriam Clucho. And we went into the hall, and there were seated the vice chancellor and the president and vice president of the parliament, many ministers, the minister of defense and the minister of culture and education, many ministers. There was the chief of staff of the Austrian army in his, you know, glorious uniform, and the commander of the Vienna district of the Austrian army, more military people. Half a dozen or more ambassadors and many members of the parliament were all there in the room. And Theo got up in front of them, and he was Theo, you've seen the videos now, disarming and charming, and said to them, "I want to thank you for inviting me and honoring me and my people to come and give you this concert at this momentous occasion. The significance of this occasion is not lost on me, that 75 years later, the mass murderers are gone, and I'm the one here singing my people's songs of peace and of freedom." And I looked around at the people of the room, and they looked to me a little bit tense. After all, it's not an easy thing. Meeting up with each other head to head is not an easy thing. We think in terms of, you know, victims and survivors and perpetrators, and here we are in this heart of Austrian lawmaking, and here's this Jew on this occasion. And there was tension, but not from Theo's side. Theo was Theo. Theo had a heart that was filled with light and was filled with love, and he loved to sing, and that's what he was going to do. And he sang his first song called Kinderjahren, My Childhood Years, and he told them about how as a child he lived in the City of Light, where the coffee houses were full of beautiful cakes and music and waltzes and intellectuals debating, and how he loved that city, and how he expected to grow up and be an adult in that city, and how his love of theater and of music was from that city, but how he had to flee for his life and became a refugee and stayed a refugee in his own heart for the rest of his life, even while comfortable in Palestine and America. He always felt like a refugee from his home in Vienna. And then he went on to give a beautiful concert with songs in Hebrew and songs in German and songs in Yiddish and French and probably some other languages. And all of the people in the room began to relax, maybe tap their feet a little bit, maybe sway a little bit with the music. And I felt like I was experiencing something holy. I had goosebumps up and down my arms, because what I was watching was an event in which we were not, God forbid, forgetting the past, and God forbid dismissing the past, God forbid, not in any way, shape, or form, but we were just allowing the love in our hearts, or the compassion and the sorrow and the regret and some affection and respect, whatever was in our hearts, we were allowing it to be present there. It all mixed together in some way, and people's eyes filled up with tears. And then Theo arrived at his last song, and he said, suddenly he was solemn again. We'd been celebrating and kind of swaying. And he said, "For this last song, the song of the deepest respect to my people, please stand at attention. This song is only sung standing, and only listen to standing." And everybody stood up at attention with their Austrian military uniforms and everything else. And Theo sang the song that he sung at this museum also many times at Holocaust Memorial Day. Zognit Keinmal, the survivor song. Never say this is our last road, because we're still here. And he sang that song 75 years after Kristallnacht. God forbid, it could have been a very different occasion 75 years later. It could have been a celebration, God forbid, of the Third Reich. But that's not what it was. It was our song. It was the survivor song in Yiddish being sung by Theo to all of the lawmakers in the land. And when that song was finished, Theo took his tallit, which he had hung over the speaker's podium. And he said, "I am a priest from a long line of Jewish priests. And these days, all that priests do are bless the Jewish people in synagogue. But I've taken permission from the chief rabbi of Austria, who was there also in the room, for this momentous occasion to do something completely unusual. And I'm going to bless you, the lawmakers of Austria, with the Jewish priestly prayer that you should continue to lead your country in the ways of righteousness, in the ways of justice, in the ways of kindness, and in the ways of peace, and that you should be a light unto the nations and show what it means to move forward, to be sorry, to have regret, and to change your ways." And he got himself under the tallit, and he put out his Kohen hands, and he gave the priestly blessing, the Birkat Kohanim. And later that night in the hotel, when it was time to go to sleep, and Theo was spent and satisfied and exhausted, and he got into bed, and he said, "You know, Moses said that everybody was created for a reason, and perhaps it was for this event that I was created." And in that moment, I took an oath to myself that I will tell this story, this holy story, as often as I could, wherever I could, for the rest of the days of my life. So thank you for listening to it, and please pass on this story. And we're gonna listen now to Theo singing Zognit Kainmul, and then that's pretty much, we're gonna have our question and answer and talk a little bit. I'm gonna tell you where you can get the book, which I would love so much if you purchased for yourself, for your grandchildren, for your children. It has all the stories we spoke of today and more. It has a lot of Hanukkah in there. It's good for Hanukkah. It has the story I just told you, which I consider so important. We'll get to that. But now let's just hear Theo singing Zognit Kainmul, please, in Yiddish. Never say never, because we're still here.
Zognit Kainmul, was du gehst den letzten Weg. Von schlimmen Bläumen verstellen bläue Tänen, als kommen wird noch unser Eus gedenkte Schon. Es wird kapäupt und unser Trock mir seinen Don, als kommen wird noch unser Eus gedenkte Schon. Es wird kapäupt und unser Trock mir seinen Don. Das Lied geschrieben ist mit Blut und nicht mit Blei. Es ist nicht kein Lied für eine Folge euch der Frei. Das hat der Volk zwischen Fahren dicke Welt. Das Lied gesungen mit Naganes in die Hände. Das hat der Volk zwischen Fahren dicke Welt. Das Lied gesungen mit Naganes in die Hände. Mit Kämmel, als du gibst den letzten Weg, von schlimmen Leinen verstellen neue Tänen, als kommen wird noch unser Eus gedenkte Schon. Es wird erbeugt und unser Trock mir seinen Don, als kommen wird noch unser Eus gedenkte Schon. Es wird erbeugt und unser Trock mir seinen Don.
Never say it's our last road, because we are still here. So now I'm very honored to be able to take questions from you and hope to answer as openly as I can. When we're done with the Q&A, we have one last kind of encore song, which you will love. It's a celebration and it's super fun. So if you possibly can, stay around for our last song. But now let's get to question and answers. And also I want to tell you, it's been in the chat the whole time. Theodore Bikel is the City of Light. All proceeds, not all proceeds, but the profit after, of course, what the book costs us and the publisher fees, the profit goes to fund the Theodore Bikel Legacy Project. my nonprofit, in which I use to keep Theo's legacy of tikkun olam and speaking up in the face of injustice and using your art in the service of making the world a better place. That's our nonprofit, the Theodore Bikel Legacy Project. The proceeds of this book go to there. AimeeGinsburgBikel.com, couldn't be more easy, www.AimeeGinsburgBikel.com. And there's a tab there where you can contact me if you're interested in buying any other Theodore Bikel, his albums, his CDs, his DVD of his Shalom Aleichem movie, Theodore Bikel in the Shoes of Shalom Aleichem, his autobiography. All of the proceeds of all of these things go to fund the Theodore Bikel Legacy Project. You can write me an email through there, AimeeGinsburgBikel.com, and I will answer you immediately and we can figure out how to do that. And you can buy the book directly with the link that's there. Jill from the museum has put it in your chat. Theodore Bikel, The City of Light, great Hanukkah gift. Okay, that was my plug.
Thank you so much. I know that I speak for so many people in the audience that this was an incredible program. I just wanted to share one comment that a survivor in our community named David Langish said, and he said, Theodore Bikel was a product of his time and his experiences only reinforced his deeply held Yiddish values of compassion, quest for justice, and love for his fellow man. He epitomized the highest values of humanity. He was a proud son of our Jewish people. And I know that that is the feeling that many in the audience have today. And I want to get to a few questions that we have. One of the questions from Nicholas is, how did Theo get interested in theater and music? Was he influenced by Vienna as a child with the opera and theater and culture? Or was it something that he came to later on in his life in Israel? Was there any one key moment during his childhood that really inspired him?
Clearly, one story that Theo loved to tell, and I love to tell as well, is how his mama, Miriam, a very proud Jewish mother, who used to, friends of Theo tell how when she would visit him in New York when he was already an adult, she would walk a little bit behind him and she'd point to him to strangers and say, my son, that's my son. So my mother-in-law told how when Theo was a little boy of 4 years old, he told her that he wanted to sing something to her. And she said, okay, sing. He said, no, I need a stage. And so she put a newspaper down on the floor and he stood up on the newspaper and sang. That was his stage. He needed a stage. So he was a ham from when he was very young. Certainly the plays, now and again, Papa or Mama took him to a play and he loved watching the plays in Vienna, loved. On the kibbutz, he found a guitar that a volunteer had left behind. He had not played an instrument before that. His parents did not play instruments, but he found a guitar hanging from its strap on a nail in a wall in one of the rooms on kibbutz. And he taught himself to play it and discovered how much he loved that and really never stopped. And the last thing I'll tell you about that is the kibbutz was kind of, you know, he wasn't doing the work. He wasn't doing agricultural work. He hated the chickens. He hated the smell of the cow dung. He did not like getting thorns in his hands. He didn't like the work. All he did was sing. And so they sent him, the kibbutz movement was having a seminar in Tel Aviv, a 3-day seminar that every kibbutz sent one representative to. And that representative was taught how to put together, if any of you have been to a kibbutz, you know, on all the chagim and all the holidays, there's like a special show, or on Shabbat, there might be a special show. So it was to teach one person from each kibbutz how to put those on, the different special programs for the show. And he was at that seminar and it blew his mind. He said, I'm an actor. That's what I want to do. He went back to the kibbutz and he said, I really apologize, but I'm leaving. And he went to Tel Aviv and ecstatically started his career as an actor, which he needed to get permission from Papa. Papa had to give permission for everything. And Papa said, as long as he also graduated in a practical subject, he would give his permission for Theo to become an actor. So Theo studied linguistics. And as some of you know, he sang in 22 languages. He actually spoke fluently in 7 of them. He spoke a little bit more in 2-3 more of them, but he sang in 22 languages, and people who speak those languages always, you know, fight and say, no, he spoke that fluently, but he didn't. He just knew how to pronounce.
That's incredible. And so actually, very recently, Holocaust Museum LA opened a virtual exhibit of the artwork inspired by Shalom Aleichem. What do you think it meant to Theo, considering his life story, to perform as Tepia the Dairyman so many times? Just considering about his experience in Austria and his family during the Holocaust and moving to Eretz Yisrael, and, you know, how do you think the character resonated with him?
Playing Tevye meant everything to Theo. I did say that he had critique of the play itself because he found it a little light, but being involved and so close to Shalom Aleichem meant everything to him. Every Tuesday night as a child, Papa sat at the table with Mama, Oma, and Theo and pulled down the Shalom Aleichem from the shelf. They owned every book of Shalom Aleichem. They owned the large set of Shalom Aleichem books, plus more. And Papa read from Shalom Aleichem every single Tuesday, and Theo knew them all by heart. And he loved them immensely. And the very first role that he got as an actor in Habima was the constable in Tevye the Dairyman, in a certain version of it. And he had 9 words, and he liked to joke, I counted those words many times to make sure how many words that I have, and they were 9. But he played a constable with 9 words. That was his first role. He earned a little bit of money and he gave it to Mama, who put it in a can and put it to the side. He read, he had Shalom Aleichem books by his bedside. He had several books always by his bedside, but there was always a Shalom Aleichem book by his bedside. When he was older, in his early 80s, he wrote a one-man show called Shalom Aleichem Laughter Through Tears. It was a one-man show of enacting Shalom Aleichem with music. It was beautiful. It did very well. And from that show developed our movie called Theodore Bikel in the Shoes of Shalom Aleichem, which is some of that play plus more. And it's an autobiographical movie of Theo parallel to the biography of Shalom Aleichem. It has Theo singing and acting, and it's just a really marvelous film. Until COVID, I was still traveling around showing the film at JCC's, but I also do have DVDs, and it's marvelous. If any of you want to have it, contact me. And the last thing I want to say about that is when they left Vienna, they had to leave the books behind, the Shalom Aleichem books behind, and they wept and wept and wept and wept. Theo said Papa wept the whole journey, even though with the excitement of arriving at Eretz Yisrael, because he was a Zionist. He really wanted to get to Israel, but he wept about the books. And then when the packages arrived, I didn't tell it on this Zoominar, but somehow Oma freed, there's an amazing story I don't have time for, but Oma actually freed their things and sent it all to Palestine. All of their things arrived in Palestine, and Joseph Bikel managed to get an entry permit for Oma, who soon followed. So Oma joined them, all of their things arrived, the books arrived, and Papa had them on a shelf. And when Papa died, Theo gave those books to the National Jewish Book Center. And so the books arrived at the National Jewish Book Center. And when Theo wanted to write the play, he wrote the National Book Center. He said, could he have a set, any set? And what arrived back to him was their set from childhood. So he has a very special connection with that certain set of books that followed him everywhere. So yes, I urge you to see the exhibit at the museum, and maybe we'll find a way to meet again and do something about that, like one afternoon or something.
I think that would be great. And there are so many people in the audience who are just sharing about these incredible opportunities they had witnessing Theo perform in a variety of different performances. I want to get to one or two quick questions before we finish on this musical interlude.
Thank you for everyone who's sharing. I wish we were in person and each one of you could stand up and say your experience. If you'd like to write it to me, please do write to me. I love nothing more than hearing about people and how they met Theo, how they heard Theo. Either just go on to aimeeginsburgbikel.com and find the tab for contact Aimee. Or if you want to write me directly, write this down, aimee@theodorebikel.org. Aimee, A-I-M-E-E, @theodorebikel.org. Those are two ways to contact me, or through the museum. I'd love to hear your stories.
So very quickly, somebody in the audience wants to know if Theo had any family members who perished in the Holocaust.
You know, Theo and his family were kind of lucky in that way, lucky, quote unquote, lucky, because there were not a lot of siblings, and a lot of the siblings he was an only child. His father's siblings had left long before to France, where they were safe. His mama didn't have siblings. And so he had family members, but they were at the level of third and fourth and fifth cousins, nobody direct, but certainly many family friends. They were 10 children, Jewish children in class in school. It was 30 non-Jewish children and 10 Jewish children. He didn't ever remember even one of the non-Jewish children, but the 10 children, they knew each other. They remembered each other perfectly. I believe two of those children were lost and the rest of them actually got out. So there was like a bubble of luck or a bubble of fortune around Theo. So he didn't lose many close people, but of course he lost all of his people, you know, so many of his people.
I know that I speak for everyone that this was an incredible performance. It felt like a performance, book talk. Before we cut to life, I just want to remind everyone that you can purchase Theodore Bikel's The City of Light at aimeeginsburg.com/store. We also have the link in the chat. I also want to remind everyone that this Sunday, November 15th at 2 p.m., we have a virtual docent-led tour of our new exhibit, Recalling a Lost World. David Lepkovsky brings the stories of Shalom Aleichem to life. On Tuesday, November 17th at 4 p.m., join us for Inside the Acid-Free Box, our monthly series that takes you into the archive for a behind-the-scenes look at some of the most fascinating artifacts in our collection. This month, we are featuring the collection of Edith Flagg, a Holocaust survivor, fashion designer, and the first person to import polyester into the United States. We will have a special guest, Josh Flagg, Edith's grandson, museum board member, and star of Bravo's $1 Million listing. You can always find more information about this program and others at holocaustmuseumla.org. Thank you, Aimee. And any last words before we conclude with To Life?
What could have been better for the anniversary of Kristallnacht than to be with you, where Theo so often on Holocaust Memorial Day or Kristallnacht was with you in person? It's been an honor, a pleasure. Please enjoy this encore and please write me, contact me. I would love so much to hear from any of you.
My good and dear and old friend, Fivish Finkel, and we'll do something together.
I'd be delighted.
We've done for years.
Let me go to the side. I always remember when we did Fiddler together, I was your butcher.
That's right.
Were my tevye.
That's right.
It was the best years of my career.
How come?
Really wonderful.
How come they give you all these sexy lines in Boston Public?
Oh, really? You know what I mean?
The innuendo.
Oh, all these innuendos and thank you, David Kelly.
All right.
Oh, are we ready?
We are ready.
I'm the butcher. You're Tevye, and I want to marry your daughter. How's that?
Have we set it up for you?
Okay. To life!
To life! Lechaim! Lechaim, Lechaim, to life!
Here's to the father I tried to be.
Here's to my bride-to-be.
Great Lechaim! To life!
To life! Lechaim! Lechaim, Lechaim, to life!
Life has a way of confusing us,
blessing and bruising us.
Great Lechaim to life!
God would like us to be joyful, even when our hearts lie panting on the floor.
How much more can we be joyful when there's really something to be joyful for?
Life, life, Lechaim!
To disciple my daughter,
my wife!
It gives you something to think about,
something to drink about.
Great Lechaim to life!
Hey, ha!
To life,
to life, Lechaim!
Lechaim, Lechaim to life!
Here's to the father I tried to be.
Here's to my bride to be.
Great Lechaim to life!
To life,
Lechaim!
Lechaim, Lechaim to life!
Life has a way of confusing us,
blessing and bruising us.
Great Lechaim
to life!
Hey!
Let me be joyful, even when I'm counting.
I have never been joyful before.
Hey!
To life,
to
life, Lechaim!
Hey, yeah!
Disciple, my daughter!
My wife!
has a way of confusing us,
messing and losing us.
Break Lechayim to life.